I'm going to talk on basics. You have given me basics of modes of mechanical ventilations, basic modes, but I have omitted that basic purposefully because it's all depends on the ventilator, what you are using. There are many modes which are coming up with the new ventilator. Actually, whether they are advanced or not, not yet proved with the recent studies. So I'll go through quickly about all those modes. Why do you need mechanical ventilations? You are just pushing a mixture of air plus gases, which is normally oxygen, into the lung via an endotracheal tube or tracheostomy tube. Then we call it mechanical ventilation. We all know that when you have a problem with the patients, we need to ventilate them. And also we have to consider many things while you are doing ventilations. Of course, the selection of mode of ventilation is very important. But I have seen that there are some institutions, they do use one kind of modes frequently than other kinds. So it all depends on its clinical familiarity or also institutional preferences. And this is mainly because of that we don't have enough evidence to suggest that one mode is better than other mode so far. So you can see this graph slide that basically we have a controlled mode of ventilation type, which can be again volume dependent or volume limited or pressure limited. And assist control mode, another control mode, which is, I'll explain what is the difference between these two. Again, that could be volume limited and pressure limited. Assist control means when patient can trigger the ventilator as well. In completely controlled mode, patient has got no right to trigger. Intermittent mandatory ventilation, again, is another ventilatory support where you can give it volume limited or pressure limited. Here, both trigger can be done by the patient and you are setting up the ventilation partly. Another ventilator called airway pressure release ventilator, I'll come to that, which perhaps may be a little bit of new to you. Pressure support ventilation, we do all use very frequently, and continuous positive air pressure ventilation, tube compensation, augmented tube compensation, there are new term is being used and is coming up with ventilator. I'll come to that, what is that advantage of this type. The objective of mechanical ventilation has been clearly explained by my previous speaker, Dr. Sinha. So I'm not going to that, but basically we need to do ventilation when you have a gas problem, so to correct the gases. When you have a work of breathing problem, patient is having severe work of breathing, you need to reduce that by doing ventilation. Third is you have to minimize the ventilator induced lung injury or the heart lung compensation. And fourth, I think it's sometimes you need to protect your airways by putting tube in, and you have to put them on ventilator in certain situations. So these are the, coming back to my topics again. So the controlled ventilation, first I'll go through volume limited ventilation. Volume limited ventilation, again sometimes called volume control, volume cycle. So you need to remember those terms. So these are the different ventilators are using different connotations. So where you in this mode, you need to set the peak flow rate and the flow pattern. And also tidal volume, which is very important, and that is why it's called tidal volume. You are fixed ring, so it's volume limited. And at the same time, you have to set respiration rate, PEEP, and FiO2. The inspiration time and inspiratory to expiratory ratio will be determined by the peak inspiratory flow rate. This is important because if you increase the peak expiratory flow rate, the time will be less, so there will be IE ratio more. But if you reduce the inspiratory flow rate, so inspiratory time will be more, so expiration time will be less, so it will increase IE I receive. ERA pressure, we all know three things comes into our mind: peak pressure, plateau pressure, and mean pressure. All depends on two things: your ventilatory setting and the patient's related variables, which means compliance of the lung, also airway resistance and tube pressure as well. Higher pressure means a consequence of large tied up volume and high peak flow, high compliance and increased airway resistance. So when you are setting up a volume control ventilator or volume limited access control ventilator, you need to set tidal volume 6 ml per kg body. That is the usual thing, respiration rate between 12 to 16. And PEEPs are normally we keep around 5 cm of water, which is known as physiological PEEP. But in case of ERDS ventilation, you have to increase the PEEP. Sometimes it might go up to 16 to 20. FiO2 is sufficient. You need to set the FiO2 to meet oxygenation goals, which has been clearly explained by my previous speakers, that we don't need to go beyond 94 to 96. So you have to have saturation between 90 to 96, and whatever FiO2 is required, you have to go for that. And then gradually, once the lung condition improves, gradually your FiO2 come down, maintaining the saturation. Peak flow rate, again, it varies from 40 liters per minute to 60 liters per minute, and depending on the peak flow rate, you can adjust your IE ratio. But the objective is to keep IE ratio between 1:1:2 or 1:3. But when you are ventilating COPD patient, you might have to increase the peak flow rate to keep the IE ratio at the lower side, 1:4 sometimes. Trigger sensitivity, again, could be of two types: every ventilator do have flow triggering or pressure triggering, and trigger normally flow triggering kept at minus 2 liters per minute and pressure minus 1 to 2 cm of water per minute. So this is the settings for most of the ventilators we are using. That coming back to volume limited, again, when you see volume limited, there are many ventilators have got many modes in the volume limited. One is called its controlled mode ventilation, where you do not allow the patients to breathe. So most of the time, these patients are completely sedated or paralyzed, or patient is apneic. So you go by the set amount of minute ventilation by setting your respiratory rate and tidal. The ventilator will give entirely the minute ventilation. But in assist control, you allow the patients to ventilate in addition to the amount you have set minute ventilation by adjusting your respiratory rate and tidal volume. In addition to that, patient will have his own breathe, and that will be augmented by the ventilator. So if the patient, you have set, say, example, 10 respiratory rate and tidal volume is 500. So you are going to get definite 5 liters of volume of gases. But if your patient is having another 10 respiration rate in addition to that, and so that 10 will be augmented by the ventilator, so again 5 liters. So effectively, patient is getting 10 liters per minute. So one mode which is known as pressure regulated volume control is very commonly used by many doctors. They feel this perhaps is more comfortable mode. I'll come to that. What is that? Here you are again setting the tidal volume, but the applied pressure changes to attain that target tidal volume from breathe to breathe. What happens, the ventilator will calculate the what pressure it has to give in its previous breathing. So if it finds that previous breathing it has to give, say, about 20 pressure to get that tidal volume, so next breathe it will give the same pressure, but it varies from breathe to breathe, because we all have got a tidal volume, physiological tidal volume, that varies from minute to minute or second to second. It's not a fixed one. So that is why the variable flow is very comfortable to the patient. So it could be a comfortable mode to the patient. So for any given tidal volume and lung compliance, plateau pressure will be the same with ACCESS control and pressure regulated volume control. Coming to intermittent mandatory ventilation, what is that? It's same as ACCESS control mode in one way, because you as clinician will determine minimal minute ventilation by setting respiration rate and tidal volume. And the patient is able to increase the minute ventilation in both the situations. But what is the difference between AC and intermittent mandatory ventilation? In intermittent mandatory ventilation, patient will have the extra breath which will not be augmented by the ventilator. Just I'll give you an example. So previously you have said the 10 rate with 500 tidal volume. So definite minute ventilation he's getting is 5 liters. And he's again having another 10 breath which in augmented AC mode will have another 5 liters, but in intermittent minute ventilation, if patient is generating say 250 tidal volume, then it will be 2.5 liters. So effectively he is getting 7.5 liters. So that is the difference. Sorry. But in SMB, which is another mode of intermittent mandatory ventilation, it is same as intermittent, but each breath is synchronized with the ventilator. That is why it's called SMB. Again, here you are allowing the patient to get the extra breath of its own breathing. And here again, SMB can be supported by pressure support when you are adding some extra pressure with that augmented ventilation. So this is marginally better than IMB, and many of us are using SMB for certain time during our patient's condition, depending on our patient's condition. Ventilatory support can range from full support to no support SMB. What is that? I'll just explain that. In this graph, you see the left side bar where you are giving assist ventilation 100%, so there is no augmented or spontaneous breathing. And on the other hand of the right bar, it's you are giving the no support at all, so assist is zero. So there the patient is taking his own breath completely. And if you are supported that spontaneous SMB with pressure support mode, then it will be just like pressure support. So coming to that, the level of support you can change, and it's very important that during ventilation, as my previous speaker has explained, that there could be hemodynamic consequences. And if a patient has got a positive pressure ventilation, then these compensations, sometimes you need to adjust your ventilator. And it has been shown in one study that your cardiac output, mean blood pressure, pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and oxygenation can be better if you could reduce the SMB support mode below 50%. And that's why in a hemodynamically unstable patient, perhaps probably this is the better mode where you can adjust the support rate. Coming to the advantage of SMB and assist control, because these are the commonly used mode in every unit, and obviously SMB has got the few advantages like better patient ventilator synchrony, better preservation of respiratory muscle functions, lower mean airway pressure, lower auto PEEP, and greater control of the level of support, as I have mentioned that you can adjust. But the question is, if you have a very sick patient or critically ill patients, and then if you put them on straight SMB mode, probably you are not right, because the SMB mode you are not have guaranteed full or near maximal ventilatory support, which can be given by your assist control mode. So if a patient, what I feel that if a patient is very sick, you go for control mode first, and then once the patient is stabilized, then you go for SMB. be mode. Pressure limited assist control mode, again it's the same kind, but here you are limiting the pressure instead of tidal volume. Rest of the things are same, and the tidal volume is variable here, where in volume control the pressure is variable. So yeah, the other things are more or less same. In contrast, the peak air pressure, what you are using here is the combination of your applied pressure, inspirited pressure plus the peak. So if you set up the pressure, say 20 centimeter of water, and your peak is 5, then your total pressure will be 25. Again, the setting is like same, in pressure control ventilation. Again, you can have the following modes, like control mode ventilation, acid control mode ventilation, and SMB. They are the same. In control mode, there is no extra ventilation allowed by the patient, and assist control you can allow, where that will be augmented by the ventilator, and SMB or intermediate ventilation, that won't be augmented, the extra mode which patient is taking beyond your respiratory rate setting. So pressure limited assist control mode ventilation setup, again it's something like your volume control, where the PEEP, FiO2, ventilator rate, trigger sensitivity is identical. Only thing you need to adjust your inspiratory pressure, which is normally set to get the tidal volume. Say if you adjust a tidal volume 6 ml per kg, then you have to adjust the pressure to get the tidal volume, which again could be between 12 to 25. So this is the thing, and inspiratory ratio has to be adjusted depending on your inspiratory flow rate. So now question is, volume limited, pressure limited, which one is better? Volume limited or volume control, or pressure limited or pressure control? I think this argument will always be there, because we don't have any study showing that one is better than other in terms of mortality, oxygen, or work of breathing. But there are physicians or intensivists prefer pressure limited ventilation, because they are in favor of that, because they know that it's a work of breathing, lower peak airway pressure in pressure limited, a more homogeneous gas distribution occurs in this ventilation, there will be improved patient ventilator synchrony with pressure limited, and perhaps in certain situation you can get the earlier winning with this mode. But again, those who goes for volume limited, they will argue that you are not getting the guaranteed ventilation in pressure limited, which will can get in volume limited or volume control. So for initial setting up of a critically ill patient, perhaps again volume control might be marginally better than pressure control. And but the studies which have shown these two with the conclusion that airway pressure is less, because they have used in volume control mode constant flow or square wave. But subsequently, when you use the ramp flow, which means distillating flow in volume control, then the pressure benefit which you are going with getting in your pressure limited will be same in volume limited as well. So it also depends on, in volume limited, what flow you are using. If you are using the ramp flow, then perhaps it's as good as pressure limited ventilation. Pressure support ventilation, it is neither a volume limited or pressure limited. What happens here, once the patient initiates the ventilation, the ventilator will give pressure, and the inspiratory flow, which works as a cycle and decreases to a predetermined percentage of its peak value, which is normally 25%. And we need to set here the inspiratory pressure support and the PEEP, and of course the FiO2, to get the desired level. The pressure tidal volume, inspiratory rate, and minute ventilations are dependent on multiple factors on pressure-regulated ventilatory support, of which one is very important, the patient-related variables. If the compliance is very high or patient is deeply sedated, then perhaps this is not a better mode. High pressure support levels normally gives you large tidal volume and low respiratory rate. Therefore, when you want to reduce the work of breathing, then you have to increase the pressure support level and also probably you have to increase the inspiratory flow. These two are inversely related to the work of breathing. Advantage of pressure support, again, it's a comfortable mode. Most of us are using this for weaning up from the mechanical ventilator. But if you see the clinical studies, they haven't shown any benefit of these modes during weaning process. On the other hand, pressure support ventilation is frequently combined with synchronized intermittent mandatory ventilations to get this effect. I'll come to that why. The purpose of adding pressure support ventilation for patients' initiated breath is to overcome the resistance of the endotracheal tube and the ventilatory support circuit. So that is why only pressure support ventilation may not be adequate. So if you go for SMB mode with the pressure support, perhaps that will give you better result during weaning process, particularly those who have got a problem during weaning. Resistance to endotracheal tube is related to the tube diameter and the airway inspiratory flow rate. We all know that. So that is why we need to have an optimum airway tube during mechanical ventilation. There are disadvantages of this mode. Each breath must be initiated, as I mentioned. So those who have got central apnea or hypopnea, probably it's not the mode. Adequate minute ventilation cannot be guaranteed with this mode. Ventilator asynchrony does happen when you are using high pressure support, and it's a pressure support ventilation interferes with your sleep pattern. It's very important. So if you put the patient on PSV in night time, so it will interfere with all four stages of REM sleep, and there will be sleep fragmentation, which certainly is going to interfere with your weaning. Relatively high level of pressure are required during full ventilatory support to prevent the alveolar collapse. So there will be more sort of, if you use high pressure, so alveoli will have a collapse, again expansion. These shearing forces can cause ventilator related lung injury. We all know that. So when you find that your patient needs very high pressure support, don't go for pressure support, go back to any control mode. While pressure support ventilation is poorly suited for COPD patients, so it's not poorly, it's not bad for COPD patient unless your support is not very high. But when you are using very high support, then perhaps you need to go for another mode, even in COPD and asthma patients. In addition, pressure support does little to reduce the auto-PEEP. So if you have a very high auto-PEEP, which is quite often in COPD and asthma patients, then you might have to go for other mode first. What is tube compensation mode? It's a many ventilator as we can be set to a automatic tube compensation mode. This mode is a type of pressure support mode which applies a sufficient level of positive pressure to overcome the work of breathing imposed by endotracheal tube, and it varies from breath to breath. So that is why it's sometimes important when you are putting a patient on TPs or spontaneous breathing trial. So in that case, sometimes we do use constant pressure sort of PEEP with a PEEP valve. But I think in the automatic tube compensation mode, if you have that in your ventilator and you add to that spontaneous breathing trial, then patient might have a better outcome, and it has been proved in many studies. So this is new mode which has come up with many ventilator. CPAP, which is not a actually it says PEEP. You are applying high PEEP or normal whatever PEEP value for both inspiration and expiration. So ventilator doesn't have any cycle more with inspiration and expiration. It's commonly used in three clinical conditions: obstructive sleep apnea, obesity, hypoventilatory syndrome, and in acute cardiogenic pulmonary edema. Bilevel positive airway pressure, again, it's a mode which has been commonly used for non-invasive ventilation, where you need to set the inspiratory pressure and expiratory pressure. The tidal volume you are going to get depending on the difference between inspiratory pressure and expiratory pressure. Sometimes you find that term used BiPAP, which is perhaps the wrong. It's not the, it's a BiPAP being used by one vent company who has given the name of BiPAP, but it should be called BPAP, bilevel positive airway pressure ventilation. Airway pressure release ventilation, it is something new where what you do, it's a again pressure support ventilator where you are giving high continuous pressure P high delivered for a long period of time T high, followed by a short period of time low pressure and low duration T, P low, T low. Just I'll show the graph. Here the inspiratory phase is prolonged with high pressure and the time is high, prolonged, and the release phase is shorter, time is shorter. So this is called pressure release ventilator. Here a pressure release ventilation. This is different. The difference between high pressure and low pressure is the driving pressure, and once it comes from high to low pressure, that will release and that causes exhalation. But the important thing is that during these two phase, you patient can have a spontaneous breathing. As you could see, the red line is showing the spontaneous breathing, so it can go with both the inspiratory phase as well. So now, is it very effective? I think so far we don't have any study showing that it improves mortality, but it has got some effect on few observations like peak airway pressure, improve alveolar recruitment, increase the ventilation of the depending part of the lung, and improves oxygenation, because it works in some way like inverse ratio ventilation, because or recruitment maneuver you are applying. So that is why it improves the oxygenation. Indication particularly, it's used for ARDS patients, but it should not be used in obstructive airway disease, because the inspiration expiration ratio is much high here, and which is quite contraindicated. Again, this mode one can have intermittent mandatory pressure release ventilation and biphasic ventilation, or bivent, bilevel, biphasic, duopap, many terms being used for many ventilators. So this is, I'll just tell you what is that, the biphasic or bilevel. Here the inspiratory phase and release phase both are equal, and in both the situation patient will have spontaneous breathing. So it's a kind of pressure support ventilation where patient's oxygenation can be improved by giving P high, which is very important, and P low will be low, and the release the expiration phase will be prolonged. Even this mode can be used for obstructive airway disease. Just I'll touch upon this because you have got a special session and another session for this high frequency ventilation, where you have to have very high respiratory rate with small tidal volume. We don't use right now in our clinical practice. Adaptive support ventilation, which is very common, very new one, where ventilator will understand the respiratory mechanics first of your patient, and then ventilator will adjust your respiratory rate and inspiratory pressure to give you the desired minute ventilation. So this is kind of a auto like auto plane. So you need to just put the ventilator in that mode and that will do everything for you. Now question is whether it's going to give you the better result for your patient. So far we don't have any support in favor of using this ventilator mode. Neurally adjusted ventilator as assist ventilation, NAVA we used to call, it's been there for a long time, but it hasn't been very popular because of the main reason that success of NAVA depends on one thing, that you need to have an intact ventilatory drive and patient has should be on spontaneous breathing. And as you know, patient with a critically ill patient, you need to sedate them, you need to reduce their drive to avoid this desynchrony. But NAVA is basically came with the idea of synchronization, which is not possible in the initial part of the ventilation, but when you are probably planning for weaning, perhaps this could be a better option. Inverse ratio ventilation is not a mode, actually. You are setting the inspiratory-expiratory time in a way that inspiration is more than expiration. Normally, we have expiration phase more than inspiration. Again, this you can use for pressure limited, volume limited. The objective of this mode is to increase the oxygenation, which we all know that during inspiratory phase, oxygenation improves. So, to summarize my talk, I would end up with the saying, following words, that mode of ventilation refers to the method of inspiratory support. During volume limited, you are adjusting the volume, and during pressure limited, you are adjusting the pressure. In volume limited, pressure will vary depending on your patient's lung conditions. In pressure limited, tidal volume will vary depending on your lung compliance and other factors. Continuous positive airway pressure refers to the delivery of continuous level of positive airway pressure. Bilevel is commonly used for NIV, and both inspiratory and expiratory pressure are being adjusted. SMB with pressure support is, as mentioned, is perhaps the best mode for good control of ventilations. And I just mentioned that when you have a patient with ARDS, respiratory failure following obstructive airway disease or traumatic brain injury, particularly for very obese patient or bariatric surgery, you need to give special attention in these situations, because you might have to change your ventilator just looking at your waveforms and ventilator modes, depending on the waveforms and the amount of the settings you have done and the results what you are getting from that settings may not be ideal in those situations. So time to time you have to change that. Several issues surrounding supportive care should also be addressed. It's like sedation and analgesia, hemodynamic monitoring, and nutrition, glucose control, and perhaps is very important ventilator associated pneumonia by using VAP bundles. And these are the things I think for during any mode when you are choosing, you need to keep an eye on all those things. So ARA pressure release ventilation and inverse ratio ventilations are particularly used for increasing your oxygenation when you have a problem with hypoxia, in spite of having your basic modes of ventilations applications, then you can go for that. So thank you all of you, and happy Durga Puja for all of you.